For example, to use your example of yesterday, if you sat down to record 4 podcast episodes in a row, you're going to be way more efficient if you just bang out one after the other, after the other, after the other.
You know, okay, you can't think this way anymore. Like, you have to change the way that you've been operating.
It was probably the most productive quarter of your life, too, right? If you did that for a whole quarter.
Welcome to the Million Dollar Sellers Podcast. I'm your host, Nick Chouquette. We've got Corey Ganim on the call today. Corey has been selling on Amazon for 7 years now. He's got a great wholesale business. I really love his topics around like lead generation, closing deals, and really just getting things done. Man, I get like that vibe from you when I see stuff. I'm like, Corey just gets shit done. You know, like he's leveraging things. He's doing more with his time. You know, you got that like Hormozy type vibe as well. So yeah, I love your content, man. I know that's something you could talk about as well, as like content creation. But yeah, excited to have you on the podcast, man.
Yeah, man. Thanks for having me back. I think first time I was here was probably what, year and a half ago ish. It's been a little bit.
Yeah, it's been a while, man. So excited to have you back on, see what you've been up to. I know you've been doing some more like content creation type stuff, like we were talking about, but I know you've still got a good wholesale business as well. So I know we're going to talk a little bit about, you know, what you're seeing in wholesale right now, what, you know, problems are we're dealing with, how we're overcoming those. I know that's going to be of interest to a lot of people. But yeah, why don't you just start by telling us a little bit about what you've been up to and, you know, what your plans are, what your vision is for the next, you know, quarter or the rest of the year.
Yeah. So great, I guess, great way to lead it off. So, I mean, I'll kind of just refresh people from the last time I've been on the show. So if you kind of want to hear my full background, how I got into Amazon, my story, check out the first episode that Nick and I did. I think it was like the first episode of season 2 of the MDS podcast. That was kind of my full background. Now, as far as what I've been up to from then to now, which is over the last maybe year and a half or so, I've been really focused on, one, building my personal brand, and two, also continuing to build my wholesale business. So on the personal branding side of things, I've been relentlessly putting out content. My main platforms are YouTube, Twitter, LinkedIn, and Instagram. So just trying to be really consistent across all of those platforms. And then on the Amazon front, like I said, big focus is on continuing to build my wholesale business. So we've been in talks with a couple of brands on landing potential exclusives or semi-exclusives, and also doubling down with some of the distributors or wholesalers that we've been working with for a number of years as well. Because, and I'm sure this is something we'll get into, but wholesale is one of those businesses where it's all about relationships, and it really just takes a couple of like key relationships with some key suppliers to kind of build your whole business, right? This is not a business where you need 100 suppliers to do decent numbers. It's a business where you need maybe 3 to 5, or, you know, 1 to 3 to really build a sustainable business. So we've just been doubling down on what's working here in year 7. May will be 7 years on Amazon for me.
Yeah, man. I really like that you touched on that doubling down piece of, you know, looking at your current partners in your wholesale business, meaning people you buy product from, and being like, hey, let's, you know, instead of looking for more of these people, let's just invest more in this one relationship or these 3 relationships.
Exactly.
Man, when I did that with arbitrage, that's when my business exploded. Like when we 100%. Were getting you know, we're getting invited to the group chats of everyone that works at the store, and they're opening the store early for us, right? And they're telling us about deals, you know, and you're bringing people into the business as buyers who know how to build relationships with people and can repeat the same type of relationship building, which is not an easy thing to teach, man. You know, you've got to be a certain type of person to be able to build relationships like that, but it's worth it.
Totally. And I mean, at the end of the day, it's just B2B sales, right? I mean, I think that's why, that's really what drew me towards wholesale as a business model, more so than arbitrage, which is a little more, I mean, the way you did it is not transactional, but, you know, typical, let's say, online arbitrage is going to be a lot more transactional. And then private label, definitely, you know, not transactional, also a very big relationship heavy business.
Yeah.
But it requires a little bit of a different mindset, right? Like, you know, having those design chops, having an eye for branding, right? These are things that aren't necessarily my skill set. But when it comes to sales, following up, relationship building, rapport building, just, you know, kind of being at the right place at the right time in terms of popping up in front of those decision makers, that's where I feel like my strengths lie. And that's what drew me to wholesale. And that's why I've stuck with wholesale.
Right? Yeah. Well, I think it's clear with your content and me just knowing you for a little bit that that's, you know, one thing that you do well is just like closing the deal, you know, filling the pipeline with leads, qualifying, closing the deal. Like, there's all these stages to that process, and you really need to be good or have people that are good in each one of them right. to have a good wholesale business. You know, I think that's what I found, man. When we were growing that thing, I mean, we were breaking Helium 10. We were always hitting the API limits like all the time. You know, worrying about sending too many emails, getting shut down, right?
Not being able to send,
not being able to send any emails because you jumped up too fast, right? You start to run into all these new boundaries, which is interesting. But that's how you know you're kind of trailblazing, man, right? Which is such a good feeling. And that's one thing I love about Amazon and this new digital kind of these digital opportunities is you get to like flex all those different skills in that same business. You know, there's times to go really fast. There's times to go really slow. There's time to, you know, rely on foundational business principles. And there's times to, you know, try new things that have never been done before.
Totally.
And it's such a great platform to like express yourself, in my opinion. So I've really enjoyed that. And that's what I see a lot of other people doing, you know, through social media and business in general. And I think Amazon lends like that. There's just a certain type of people, you know, they're
totally
like unique people. We were talking about community building and you know, that's what I get out of MDS as well, is just that exposure to those like-minded people. So I'm curious to hear like some other things that you're doing in the business that might offer some leverage to other people. Like, are there any tools helping you pump out or edit your content in a faster way to get that stuff published? And then let's talk a little bit about some of the things you're facing in your Amazon business and how you've overcome those. I know inbound fees and just logistics in general is a big topic right now.
Yeah. And all topics that we should definitely cover. But to kind of answer your first question, right, about like on the content creation side, how am I like getting stuff out there consistently? Well, you know, there's nothing like sexy about it. It's not like there's a specific tool that I use that nobody else is aware of. It's just the concept of batching, right? I think that that's been really effective for me in the sense that like on Mondays, I don't do any call. I don't schedule any calls on Mondays. Mondays are kind of like my content day, right? Where I sit down and that's where I'm going to bang out. I'm going to schedule 2 tweets per day for the next week, right? So that kind of covers Twitter. I'm going to go ahead and write and schedule my newsletter for the week, which goes out on Thursday. I might record a podcast episode or two, which I release once a week every Wednesday. And then I'm going to sit down and do any sort of other video content, right? Like batch a couple of YouTube videos, batch a couple of just like kind of, you know, iPhone in front of the face, talking head type videos, and post a couple of stories as well. So I think by knocking out a lot of the content load for the week there on Monday, like my Mondays are super, you know, it's a long day because it's a lot of work to do that for the week, but it makes the whole rest of the week easier. And then from there, batching my calls into, I try to do like between 1 and 4 p.m. on Tuesdays and Wednesdays, knock them all out, right? I'll have calls back to back to back to back during those days, which allows me to, again, focus on the content on Mondays and then kind of have the mornings for more like deep work, which is when I sit down and actually work on a project or, you know, work on infrastructure, do those things that actually move the needle. And as far as your second question, I know that kind of touched on the content side of things. What was that second question again?
Yeah, so that was like stuff happening in Amazon right now and any other, you know, hacks you can think of in the business. And when I say hacks, I like to think of like leverage points. right? I do like what you mentioned though about what you're doing, because batching content, like I would consider that a hack, right? Mm-hmm. Because it takes things to the next level. And I think people miss stuff like this, because sometimes when I, like when I'm sharing these ideas with some people, they kind of like hit you with this blank stare. Like, why would you even think about that? And, but I think about those moments, like podcasting is such a good one, which we both can relate to, right? Like yesterday I did 4 podcasts and I only had to set, I only had to set up my stuff once, right? But I did 4, right? So that's a big point of leverage there, where I didn't have to spend that time to set that stuff up. And it's not just time. It's like energy. I didn't have to deal with, you know, technical problems or, you know, this wire not working, right? Like all that stuff was drastically cut. And that stuff matters. You know, I think it's like time and like brain power that you're reserving there to have a bigger impact on like those deep sessions that
you're
having.
Well, it's like the context switching too, I think is what, you know, I think that's kind of what it's referred to, where it's like, if, for example, to use your example of yesterday, if you sat down to record 4 podcast episodes in a row, you're going to be way more efficient if you just bang out one after the other, after the other, after the other, as opposed to, all right, I'm going to sit down and record a podcast episode, then I'm going to go answer a couple of emails, then I'm going to come back and record another episode, then I'm going to fire off a purchase order to my supplier. And if you go back and forth like that, it's going to take you literally the entire day to do those things you mentioned. Whereas if you just, again, batch the podcast and then batch the other tasks,
yeah,
you're going to be way more efficient. Oh, and another kind of, you know, call it a tip, call it a hack, whatever you want to call it, that has really helped me, especially as of recent, is setting timers, like setting deadlines, okay, right? Like very artificial deadlines. So a practice that I've implemented probably over the last month or two is what I call like a power hour, right? First thing in the morning. So my routine, I wake up, go to the gym, come home, go on a short little walk outside. And then as soon as I get inside from my walk, which is right around like 8:30 a.m., then I set a 1 hour timer and I call it the power hour. Phone's on airplane mode. I'm locked in on my desk. I've got the, you know, like the lo-fi beats going in the headphones, like super focused for 60 minutes straight. And that's kind of the goal. It's like, all right, I'm going to focus on my most important task for the next 60 minutes. When that 60 minute timer goes off, I step away. And that's when I sit down and have breakfast. And what I found, Nick, I swear, it's crazy, because you hear people talk about this, and until you actually experience it, you're like, no way, that's not true. But I'll get more, like there's some days when I get like 70% of my work done in that 1 hour, because I'm focused, I'm locked in, I'm not looking at my phone. And, you know, I sit down and have breakfast, and by the time I'm done with breakfast, it's maybe 10 a.m. And I'm like, okay, well, you know, I have maybe 1 hour of work left. And then the rest of the day is geared towards, you know, recovery or like thinking about strategy type, you know, thoughts and conversations, and also just like calls, which I found that if I could actually execute that power hour, like on the days that I can get that done, it makes the rest of the day and the rest of the week just so, so much easier.
Yeah, it's great. And it really does feel like a power hour, man. I like the first quarter I did this wake up and work thing. I've talked to some people about it, but for me to really get that time to myself, I get up pretty early, like 3:30, 4 o'clock. And I did that for like the whole first quarter. And, you know, I was working like from then to like 7 o'clock. I would do a little deep like yoga nidra type thing at like 6:45 to 7. And then I'm making food for the kids, breakfast, getting them packed for lunch, and then taking them out around the neighborhood, because my son, my oldest, goes to school at like 9, right? So we've got a good, well, the other kid go to school at like 11:15. So one of them's around for a while. But yeah, so now I've gone from someone stressed out about not feeling productive at work, feeling like I could be spending more time with my family, to someone who's feeling like they've accomplished both those things by like 11 a.m. every day.
It's probably the most productive quarter of your life too, right? If you did that for a whole quarter.
Yeah. And I did get thrown off a little bit with, like, honestly, allergies, which are still kicking my ass. Might have been so allergy bad people, the last like we get it. Like I get it. I think Corey probably gets it too. Like I was reading about the impact like on Google and it was like, oh yeah, lowers quality of life, depression. Like allergies all can be such a drain.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Trust me. I was on the golf course this past Saturday and might have been bad the last couple of weeks, but it was like the second I stepped foot on that course, I was sneezing every 30 seconds. Like we had to stop after 9. I'm like, guys, I'm sorry. Like it's that bad. So I get it.
Yeah. It shuts things down. So yeah, I've been thrown off track, but yeah, for anybody who's trying to take their productivity to the next level, you really got to start thinking about how you can squeeze more out of the time you already have, not how do I get more time? Because then you got to start, you know, making trades, you know, mm-hmm. I can't really do that. Right. I'm like, you know, sorry, kid number two, you know, See you later. All right. Kid number four. Right. Like I can't do that. So you've got to start thinking about maximizing your time. And I think batching your content, and then just doing things that increase your ability to produce. And I just came across some training and I got in their funnel and I realized I had all the other pieces of recovery, but I was missing this wake up and work thing where the guy was like, yeah, just wake up and work. Like
it's like simple as that.
Just get to work like within 3 minutes. So that's what I was doing, man. In my pajamas at the desk, working in the zone within like 15 minutes and feeling great.
Well, and I think Hormozy's talked about that too, right? Like that's his thing. It's like, you know, you don't need a morning routine. I think his thing is like alarm goes off, makes a cup of coffee and then sits down and gets to work. And then I think, you know, does that until around noon. I think his thing is like no calls before noon. And I've heard other like big guys, like, I don't know if you're familiar with Lewis Howes, like the School of Greatness podcast. He's a very big podcast. So same thing, just wake up, get to work for a couple of hours and then, you know, it's not like you're doing that all day.
Right.
But the idea is if you can knock out the most important stuff first, or at least make a big dent in it, then the rest of the day is easier and you can kind of save the afternoon for your calls or for that type of work that maybe isn't as needle moving, if you want to put it that way.
Yeah. And I think that stuff's critical, man. And this is not, I swear you don't hear a lot of people talk about this, but like working remotely is, you know, if while it feels probably, not new to us, like it's new to a lot of people in, you know, in civilization in general, like if you look at it historically, this is a new thing and you've got to start to think about how you're managing like all these inputs into your brain,
right?
And what it does to you, and that takes a lot of practice, man. So I think just having that block, you know, having those time blocks helps you kind of set your day up in a predictable way, which allows you to then manage those unpredictable things in a better way. And you show up better too. Like, man, I was showing up so good on the calls. Like I'm here for you guys. Like I have nothing else to do. Like, you know, what problems do you have? You know, and I'm just like handling all of them. Yep. So it's such a big shift. And then the other thing you get from it is like those feeling that feeling of productivity. That like boosts your feelings of well-being in general. I think that's something you don't really hear a lot of people talk about because you kind of got to be willing to try that new thing that seems a little crazy, like waking up and working or, you know, no calls after, you know, before 12 p.m. to really start to feel that effect. And that's why I love to call that stuff out because I want people to hear those results and be like, all right, you know, I need to give this a shot. You know, next two weeks, I'm doing this and I'm not going to judge it until then, you know?
Yeah. And I think, for most people, it's like, hey, test it out for yourself, right? And are there a lot of people out there that aren't morning people? So it's like, okay, well, maybe you don't do it first thing in the morning, but maybe you do it for your last hour at night, right?
Because
there are a lot of people that they operate best at night. Me personally, I'm useless after like 4 p.m. So that's, and I've always been a morning person, so I know that about myself, and I try to set my environment up to kind of optimize for that. Now, here's another tool that I've been using probably for the last few months or so that's kind of aided in this, like more so like productivity type tool. And so there are a few tools out there like this, but it's like a calendar tool It's like an AI-based scheduling tool, right? It's called Motion. I think it's like motion.app or something like that. So in the past, I'd use one called Reclaim, reclaim.ai, similar to Motion, but just far inferior. So I switched over to Motion. And really what I do is I program like those like blocks of work that need to be done each day. So I've got like my power hour that's scheduled in there every morning from 8:30 to 9:30. I've got like breakfast scheduled as well, right? Like this is stuff that you wouldn't think like, well, do I need to schedule breakfast? Well, it's like, if you want to be productive, if you want to get stuff done in like truly the most efficient way possible to have actual free time, then yeah, that's something you got to do. And what I love about this particular tool is that, I mean, for example, today, I had a 9:30 call run a little late. So I started my breakfast, you know, 20 minutes later than normal, which for most people would kind of throw off their entire schedule. But with this AI-based tool, all you have to do is just tell it like, hey, this is when I started breakfast, right? Which is 20 minutes later than normal. And then it's going to reorganize all your tasks to now fit in with that schedule that you're now on, right? Which is essentially 20 minutes behind. And that's really, really helped me stay productive as long as I'm being disciplined with like, all right, if I start something late, I got to make sure the calendar knows so that they can readjust and then discipline myself to kind of stay on that structured schedule. And when I do that, there are days where, like we said, it's like I'm done at 1 p.m. or 2 p.m. Yeah. And I don't, like in the past, I feel guilty about like, oh, I've got 3-4 hours of free time. Like, was I really that productive? Is there more stuff that I could get done? But now it's like, I know exactly what I accomplished already today. I know I was productive. Here's like everything that I got done. And, you know, this next 3 hours, like if I want to go to the driving range, I'll do that. If I want to hang out, I'll do that. Like it's not, you know, you don't feel as guilty.
Yeah, it's a good feeling, man. I think it's so critical. You know, for me, it's really made a big impact, you know, on me as someone with like ADD, right? So, you know, whatever that really means, but like I have it, whatever it is, I get distracted easily. You know, I'm always trying to get my hands and do a lot of things because I get excited about new stuff. But you, and then working in the world that we do, like you, there's endless amounts of ideas and opportunities and ways to do things and new things to try. So you end up overloaded. And I remember when I connected Google to ClickUp tasks to Google Calendar. You could check the box. I had a separate email account that I connected it to. So I checked the box to like populate the ClickUp stuff on my calendar. And then you can see like, oh, wait, all this stuff I'm trying to do does not fit into the hours I have available to me.
Right.
And that's one of those things where in my mind, I had like a shift. It was like, you know, okay, you can't think this way anymore. Like you have to change the way that you've been operating.
Right. It's more of like a reframe than anything.
Yeah. Yeah. And getting it on that calendar, man. So I think for someone who's overwhelmed with tasks, you know, if you're living in that digital world, you know, you've got to start to operate a little differently than people would before, you know, you'd be sitting, you know, here doing what me and you are doing and talking about selling on Amazon.
Right.
Right. Because I think that's how a lot of our brains still look at that stuff.
Agreed,
until you encounter that scenario, like seeing your tasks on a calendar and you're like, oh, I don't have the hours to do all these things available to me. There's nothing I can do about that. So yeah, man, these are some great tips for productivity. And, you know, I think a lot of this stuff applies to like your Amazon business as well. I heard someone say, I think it was someone in the group today, it was like data over emotions. Right. And I see so many people make decisions based on emotions. You know, they had this one experience or they heard about this person who had this one experience and they're not testing this stuff themselves. Like you have to get that data to really make a decision on these things. So like trying the productivity thing, like just give it a shot, you know, try the time blocking, try the batching. Try to work in the morning or at night and then just wait and see what happens. And then apply those same methods to like, you know, we have that tool that some members talk about, Jungle Ace, where they split test like market creatives.
That's the example I was just about to make and talking about like data over emotion. That's the exact example I was going to make, I think it's perfect, right? It's like, for example, split testing that hero image. It's, you could have an image where you're like, oh, this is a great image. I love the packaging. I love the colors. Like, this is my favorite and this is the one I want to go with. But in reality, once you split test the main image on a PicFu or another similar tool, come to find out customers actually hate the one that you like and they really like the one that you hate, right? Yeah. So what are you going to do? Are you going to make the emotional decision and go with the one that you like? Well, if you're a smart business owner and you want to make money, no, you're going to go with what the data says. So, and that's to draw it back to the productivity stuff, right? It's like, again, do it for 2 weeks, see what the data says. If you feel more productive, if you got more done, if it's directly contributing to the growth of your business, then, well, if your emotions tell you that you don't like it, you kind of need to get over it if you truly want to be, you know, more productive, if that's going to serve you.
Yeah, it's a more freeing way to like operate too. Like I there's so many times where I throw my hands up and I'm like, I don't know yet. You know, I don't have
right.
the data I need to make a decision, or I haven't had the experiences really to make a decision. You know, and I see some people sometimes, man, where they just like, they're agreeable and they act like they understand, and like, you know, this person, or you've been working with this person in your head, and you're like, you don't know. Like, you're just like, you know, you're just acting like, you know, because for whatever reason. Right. And it's just so important to really, know your business and what you're doing. If you want to work at like the level that we do, right? Like if you want to have a lead generation machine that pumps out emails in an automated manner, you've got to know every nitty gritty detail about that and the variables and making sure it's working right. You know, if you want to do something like send 100 emails a week, for example, like that was our goal when we were doing big wholesale lead gen, was sending 100 emails a week. You can't be cranking that out if it's not right. You know, then you're just sending out a bunch of stuff that's screwed up.
Either you've got to like master that system yourself as the business owner, or you've got to have somebody on your team that can kind of run point on that, right? And I think that's something that I feel like is a hotly debated topic. It's like, oh, well, do you hire somebody if you don't truly understand it yourself, or do you learn the system yourself intricately and then hire someone to kind of replace you? And there's definitely, I don't think there's a right or wrong answer there. I think that both sides can be true.
Yeah.
I think it's the wrong answer if you're like, oh, I'm too lazy to learn this, so I'm just going to hire somebody and hope that they can figure it out. Well, that's not the right approach. But if it's, hey, I have a general understanding, I know that me taking my efforts away from the other stuff I'm working on and trying to learn this is going to actually detract from the overall goal, then it's okay, let's hire somebody who knows this a lot better than me, right?
Right.
So I think looking at things from that perspective as well, like to kind of go back to your lead gen system example there is kind of a good way to look at it.
Yeah, and that's a good skill to develop, is knowing, you know, when to make that decision, to know when you've acquired enough knowledge to where you can hire someone else to do it. And that's something I have to like try to always remember and continue to get good at, because it's not an easy thing to navigate. But with tools like Upwork and Fiverr, you know, really, you can get anything done. You can get anything done, you know, if you navigate that world kind of carefully.
And to kind of bring that back to the context of the wholesale business on Amazon, because this is a super common example I've seen for years, right? People, they get into wholesale, maybe they get a little traction, or maybe they're still brand new and they say, okay, I'm going to hire a VA, right? I'm going to hire a virtual assistant. And they make the cardinal mistake of hiring a virtual assistant to do their sourcing for them, for example. When in reality, sourcing is that one task, especially early on, that moves the needle, right? You make your money when you source, you make your money when you buy. That's how you make your money in a wholesale business. And so that is a huge mistake that wholesale sellers make, is maybe they're okay at sourcing, or maybe they're still brand new to it and they say, oh, I'm gonna hire somebody to do my sourcing for me. When in reality, that is a task that I will firmly plant my flag in the ground and say that, like, you've got to be a master at sourcing before you can hire someone to come on and handle that aspect of your business for you, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I handled that aspect of my wholesale business for multiple years, right? So 100% me before I brought someone on to handle that. And the beautiful thing about that is over the last 4.5 years that she's been handling that, she's now better at that than me, right? Yeah. So there's now situations or products where I'm looking at it and I'm like, you know, I don't know about this. Let me ask my buyer, right? Let's see what she thinks. And like now she more or less has the final say on certain stuff because she's more, honestly, more experienced at it than I am now.
So that's a good feeling, man. That's a good feeling. Yeah.
Totally.
I like to, if I'm trying to get some help with something and I know there's that like, you know, element to it that I don't really want to give up, I kind of like batching, you know, tasks. I like to kind of batch like pieces of the work and be like, okay, you know, the virtual assistant, they can do this part and prepare it for me to make, you know, the ultimate call or whatever. I think that's one workaround if you're trying to bring in some help on something that's critical.
They kind of just like tee up the work, like tee up the actual, like the final mile for you more or less.
Yeah. Make it easy for me to make a decision.
Exactly. And that's how, I mean, that's how we still operate in our wholesale business, right?
Yeah.
Buyer will tee up a PO, right? And now they've got the authority to pull the trigger on orders under a certain dollar amount. But if it's over that dollar amount, they pretty much spell it out for me and almost like pitch me the deal, right? They say, hey, this is why I think we should buy this. So all I have to do is spend 5 to 10 minutes going through and almost just spot checking their work, and I can give it the thumbs up or the thumbs down, which is huge leverage, right? Because if that's a $50,000 or $100,000 purchase order that we're gonna make a 25% ROI on, you're talking, you know, 10 minutes of my effort to produce a potential five figures in profit, because the inventory is gonna go straight from the supplier to Amazon, or it's gonna go from the supplier to the 3PL to Amazon. Like that's the type of leverage that I've been working to build, and I think it's been really helpful in our business.
I love that you mentioned that because people underestimate it, and it makes me think of the Scoutify 2 inventory lab app that had the ideal buy feature. You could customize it and it was like thumbs up or thumb down. That's how I trained my buyers. I was like, if it's a thumbs up, buy it. If it's a thumbs down, don't. And I would just program all their, all, you know, the app. I had them set up as a user, man. I mean, that thing made me so much money, I feel like. Thank you, Scoutify. Right.
Well, it's, again, it's like, you know, you train them. I mean, obviously you train them more than once. It's ongoing training, but the idea is you get them up to a baseline level of skill. You let them kind of go out there and learn, and then you're almost like checking their work, which takes 5% of the time, 10% of the time that it would for you to actually do the work yourself. And the idea is that over time, it takes maybe 3% of your time, 2% of your time. And then maybe if they're good enough, they're autonomous, right?
Right.
They come to you and say, hey, this is what I did. Let's review what I did, but it's already been done. And because they're so good at that point, now you're like, okay, hey, that was great, right? Or hey, maybe I would have done this a little differently. Not a big deal, but let's just keep that in mind next time around.
Yeah. It's a great opportunity for training. And leveraging, you know, your time as well, which is, that's how I'm always thinking about the business. You know, it's great to have a platform that allows us, to, you know, be like, hey, how can I make this as easy as possible for me?
Yep.
And like actually do it. So it's great, man. Well, Corey, I know we're running out of time. Did you want to mention any tips you have for me? Are you guys dealing with inbound placement fees? For me personally, I'm not super concerned about them. You know, we've pivoted to doing like full truckloads, which I've talked a little bit about on the podcast recently. Happy to always touch on that again, but I'm also curious to hear how you're navigating kind of the new things that Amazon has rolled out.
Yeah, and so the inbound placement fees are a huge, like, hotly debated topic, especially among arbitrage sellers and wholesale sellers, right? Because it really affects us probably the most. And now, so we are doing a lot of full truckload shipments as well, which has kind of mitigated that to a point. But for example, we sell a lot of like razor blades, right? And these are super small. So it's just not feasible to be selling, you know, or sending in a truckload of razor blades at a time. So there's plenty of situations where we're sending, you know, 4 or 5 case packs, which ends up being hundreds of units, that end up getting split among a couple of different FCs. So previously what we were doing is, you know, most of our suppliers ship directly to Amazon for us. So we place a PO, they give us the box weight and dimensions, and we just send them the labels, they slap them on and they send them to Amazon. Well, now with the inbound placement fees and Amazon being a little pickier about where we're sending stuff, same process, but instead of them packing up the orders first, we're creating the shipment first, and then we're telling them how to pack it. Right. So we might be saying, hey, guys, we need 100 units in this box, we need 200 units in this box, and 100 in this box. Whereas previously, they might have just put everything in one box, right? So it's just being super proactive, over communicating, and telling them why we need to do things that way, right? Because it's obviously more hassle for them to pack things in three boxes as opposed to one, but it's like, hey guys, for us to continue to maintain our volume of business with you guys and to increase that further, this is how we need things done. It's not our decision. We're at the mercy of Amazon, but it's a good thing because we're going to be able to increase our business further with you guys as a result, right?
Yeah.
And so I think kind of always, I always try to frame things, especially if, you know, they might be a little bit of a pain for the supplier, always try to frame things in the context of what is going to put more money in their pocket, right? How is this going to help us do more business with them?
Yeah, that's such another good a good tip as well. Like, because it's in reality, if you continue to adhere to Amazon's, you know, guidelines and what they're making you do, like that increases your ability to do business on the platform, which, you know, gains them more brand awareness and you know, customers potentially. So right. you've got to recognize that and call it out. I see a lot of Amazon people. They undervalue themselves. They devalue what they bring to the table. And they kind of get like, you know, pushed around. Like I think about all the, cause I've done some brand management, man, like all those contracts in bed, everybody's going to get rid of you. Like, if you tell me you have a brand management agency and you're, you know, you retain customers like longer than, you know, 3 years, like I'm going to have some questions because, you know, you get tired of looking at that on your P&L.
Right.
You know, when you're paying out that agency, you know, so you said you're doing the full truckloads. Are you doing anything like, with AWD or a third party warehouse? Are you changing anything up there? Cause we're moving mostly to AWD and trying to just fit into Amazon's pipeline for logistics.
Yeah, so we're not doing anything with AWD at the moment. We have had a couple of reps on that side reach out and look to explore that with us. But just based on our business model, it's a lot of, you know, it's a lot of products that we don't necessarily have the ability to restock. So if anything, the low inventory fee is going to be more of a factor for us than the placement fee.
Yeah.
So it's something that we are just continuing to monitor, seeing like, all right, how is this going to affect our catalog? Which products make sense to keep after factoring in these fees, of which products just aren't worth the squeeze anymore.
Yeah.
So still using 3PLs, but really the majority of our inventory goes from the supplier straight to Amazon. I'd say probably like 90% of it, at least 95%.
Nice. Well, yeah, Corey, I know you're real active in the business, man. So we'll have to bring you back on and just see, you know, what's going on in the industry. It's always cool to talk to someone who has a good pulse on the wholesale side of things. You know, I'm not actively like growing that piece right now, although we are getting ready to kick off our lead gen machine again for wholesale. So I'm excited to see how that plays out. But yeah, it's just cool data, man, to see. And, you know, when I go back and dig in and look at like everything that we had before, it's like, you know, just lots of opportunity. There's so many brands out there and products to sell, and wholesale is such a quick way to get access to them. I mean, it's an insane business model to have an opportunity to build. It still blows my mind sometimes.
And it's one of those things too, where, you know, they're always going to be the naysayers that, you know, they kind of pat on Amazon as a platform and say, oh, you know, Amazon's pushing sellers out and it's getting harder every year. And it's like, well, it is, but at the same time, that's a good thing, right? Because it's one of those things where like only the strong will survive. And you hear a lot of people talking crap about wholesale and saying like, oh, it's not sustainable. Margins are shrinking, this, that, and the other. And it's like, well, margins are shrinking if you're selling bad products, but if you're partnering with good brands and you're reselling good brands, it's a non-issue, right? So it's one of those things where regardless of what anybody says, as long as Amazon has a marketplace, we're going to have businesses and wholesale is going to be even a bigger component of that marketplace, I think, in the future. I strongly believe that.
Yeah, that's why another thing I love about MDS, because you get to see that stuff happening. Like, I know there's people having success in wholesale. I know a guy in the group that his whole business model was low margin, high volume products.
Yeah. Yep.
So yeah, being a part of, you know, something like MDS or a community in general, you know, allows you to see those things and be like, okay, you know, it's real, it's happening. Well, Corey, where could people find you, man? I know you are active on social media. So before we sign off, why don't you let people know where they can hit you up?
Yeah, so best channel by far is going to be YouTube, and that's just going to be at Corey Gannum on YouTube. I've got a podcast episode that comes out there every Wednesday, and then another regular upload every Sunday. So if you're looking to learn the business, or you know, even learn some of the higher level tips and concepts, I put out a lot of content around that stuff as well. YouTube is the best place to find me.
Right on. All right, Corey. Thanks for coming on, man. I appreciate it.
All right. Thank you, Nick.